Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Now, you were in the GST Council. Can you tell us what it was like? Has it lived up to its promise of being a new federal institution of power, or does it sort of depend on the whims of whoever may be running it from the union government at times?
In fact, one of the major things was in the GST Council that nobody discussed along party lines. Gujarat and Maharashtra, BJP ruled states had huge issues, but they were sorted out with consensus. You had genuinely created an institution of federalism.
We're sitting here at the Artha Dialogues with Haseeb Drabu, who was till recently Finance Minister of Jammu and Kashmir. We're going to talk today a little bit about some of the subjects that we're interested in here, one of which is the state of Indian federalism and how it impacts the idea of India that we've lived with. Haseeb, tell us about what happened between the centre, between the union government and Jammu and Kashmir recently, and how that impacts the notion of states having a right, Indian states having a right to just exist.
Yeah, there are two parts to it. One on JNK, on the 5th of August, the special status of JNK was unilaterally abolished. It has constitutional implications and implications, of course, on India as a republic, because we've now decisively seem to have moved from a republican democracy to a majoritarian democracy. And that has implications not just with states, but with people.
Absolutely.
Because at the end of the day, underlying the constitution is a social contract. And that contract has been violated. So that's an issue. But that really doesn't come under the rubric of federalism, because if you look at Article 370, which has now been rescinded, it in some way was outside the federal part. And that's why federal theorists would call India an asymmetric federation, because there were some states like JNK and of course some others in Northeast, as much, did have certain powers which other states didn't have. JNK started off with having residuary powers and so on. So while the first part about 370 really is not within the federal setup, it is more about the idea of India as a republican democracy, the second part of what has happened in JNK, which is bifurcation of the state and conversion of a state into a union territory without consent from the state government. A person appointed by the union government gives consent on behalf of the state government, having powers what elected representatives have, and it gets converted into a union territory. There is hardly any discussion in the parliament about it. That doesn't surprise me as much as what surprises me is that the Indian civil society, the political analysts, the constitutional experts, the federalists,
And other state parties
haven't even had a word to say about this. Now, what prevents...
With one or two exceptions, the DNK, I think.
Yeah, perhaps, but maybe, but not the kind of extent to which one would expect it to happen.
Quite.
Now, what prevents the union government from declaring Darjeeling a union territory? Or even why not? We are in Kerala. Why not could be declared a union territory tomorrow for whatever reasons? No explanations. Or, you could have a union territory of Bombay tomorrow, Mumbai. So, what you've done is, you have violated the social compact, the political compact with state governments. Now, when you see this in the overall context of what's been happening, it's a very dangerous trend. In fact, I would think this is the biggest stress that the system is facing today. From small issues like amending the RBI Act by pretending it to be a money bill and pushing it through the
lower house without consulting the house of the states.
That's right. Now, this is a gross violation of the federal compact. And the whole idea earlier was, even with this government, I recollect with a lot of respect and fondness, the first three budgets of Arun Jaitley. In fact, I called them the Union of States budget, because it was the first budget that had actually made such provisions for it, or even the acceptance of the 14th Commission Award that was done by this government. But all of a sudden, you see, in the next commission, The terms of reference are changed. Everything is getting haywire, and I would.
We'll come to the Finance Commission in a minute. I want to start by saying yes. I mean, I'm glad you brought up there's been, in some senses, a movement over time, because in 2014, I think the Prime Minister had been previously a very successful Chief Minister in terms of popularity, in terms of presence. And he had come in talking about cooperative federalism. In fact, he had said that the National, Development Council consisted of the central government talking down to state leaders, and he didn't appreciate that. So there was a sense that, as the first person who'd been a state chief minister to take over for some time, there would be a slightly different approach. But one of the things that we thought would be the harbinger of this approach was the GST, which I think a lot of people, I mean, it was after much negotiation. Gujarat itself had been a holdout when the Mr. Modi had been chief minister there. But the states were eventually brought on board, consent was achieved, and the GST Council was formed, which was a new federal experiment. Now, you were in the GST Council. Can you tell us what it was like? Has it lived up to its promise of being a new federal institution of power, or does it sort of depend upon on the whims of whoever may be running it from the union government at times?
I, in fact, was very, very bullish about GST Council. In fact, I called it India's first genuinely federal institution, where states had a role to play.
And they talked to the center as equals.
As equals, mathematically, weightage-wise, yeah. But the contribution at that point of time of the then finance minister, Arun Jaitley, was that we took hundreds of decisions. Not one was put to vote. Even if a small state would raise an issue, I remember on Manipur fried fish, we spent half an hour trying to convince them. What is the reasons for, not cutting the rates and stuff like that? What it gave you a sense of empowerment. Though there were many...
There was voice delivered.
Yeah, there were voice, they were listened, they were adhered to. We made contributions, we raised apprehensions. And there was a genuine sense among people that states had kind of given up their powers. But I saw it more as sharing of sovereignty, which is really what federalism is about. Federalism is not about sharing of taxes. It's about sharing the power to raise taxes. And we had pooled that sovereignty. For the first time, centre had given up. In fact, I remember asking Mr. Jaitley that, in some ways, your budget becomes redundant because its expenditures are well known. On the tax side, direct taxes, you're not going to change every now and then. Indirect taxes, you have no role to play now. So the part B of the budget, in some way, we had lost, but he had a certain view and the gravitas that he had. He said, I'm very happy doing this because it's in the larger interest of the country.
Yeah.
And that's where we all pulled together. In fact, one of the major things was in the GST Council that nobody discussed along party lines. Gujarat and Maharashtra, BJP rule states had huge issues, but they were sorted out with consensus. You had genuinely created an institution of federalism within the thing. And I thought it was an experiment worth trying, not just for federalism, but also how to bring about legislative change. We used to draft laws on the fly, discuss it in the council. It was brilliant, and I had wonderful experience working with the council. Then all of a sudden, somewhere after Mr. Jaitley left, very unfortunate things that he passed away, there always seems to have been some. I'm not a part of the council, so I don't know how the functioning is, but I do see rate cuts happening every now and then. But even now, I don't think that a decision has been taken on a vote basis. So the DNA has been structured in a certain manner that it remains a federal thing. But what it does is, in some ways, where you can see that in a situation like today when there's economic slowdown, you will see states under pressure. But because the council originally had built up a compensation formula for 5 years, there's still protection. I think it's one of the things that I hope continues the way it started off.
So, I mean, you began by saying that you see this as one of the major sort of axes, maybe the major axes of Indian politics going forward, this pressure on the federal politics. So we'll get to two of the sort of rather complicated questions about this now. And the first is maybe demographics. And we've seen a different demographic trajectory take place in various different parts of the country, which means, you will have delimitation questions come up. You will have differing, we will have maybe some states beginning to believe they're part of a permanent political minority. Do you see this as something that can be addressed going forward by, you know, through some kind of power sharing arrangement such as the GST Council?
Well, going forward, I would have thought that, you know, institutions need to be built, because the way federalism has been structured in this country was for a specific context. And one of the problems I have with the federal structure today is it's really wholesale borrowed from the colonial concept of federalism. Most of the stuff, including sharing of taxes, is actually, should I use the word, plagiarized from Government of India Act 1935. So the construct of federalism in India, at the time of independence, had a certain requirement. You were pooling in 560-562 states, and you know, there was a certain apprehension that there were physical tendencies. So there was a certain bias towards it. It was also meant for a closed economy. Things have moved. We are now an open economy, regulatory economy. States have no clue.
It was also, I mean, to be frank, I mean, it also lasted because we were a one-party state effectively in many ways.
Well, you are beginning to go back to that situation now. So,
no,
you
but
know.
There was bargaining within the Congress.
Which may happen even now. But the real point is that the design of federalism needs to be altered. Now, today what I see is what worries me. So it's not about really about, you know, those issues of demographics will have to be addressed. And states will collectively at some point of time have to have a say in these. Now, the NDC itself would have been a good interstate council. Is there, but they're all defunct bodies, really. Well, one would need to think afresh of what kind of a forum needs to be created, which has a certain autonomy and, it, you know, it's built up in a certain manner for these issues to be addressed. I would think that the institutional route is, of course, the only route, but there should be some rethinking on the design of federalism in India.
So let's talk now about the other really sort of controversial thing, and maybe the one that's a little closer on the horizon than delimitation of constituencies, and that is the next Finance Commission. And you've already mentioned it in passing once. A lot of people are concerned about the terms of ref. So the Finance Commission is a constitutional body. It's not supposed to take a stand between the union and the states in any particular way. But the union government tends to be able to has traditionally drafted the terms of reference, right? And this time the terms of reference have raised questions. So could you sort of...
Oh, I mean, this, I have said this in a number of forums also. I've said this in writing. This is by far the worst, most regressive terms of reference that any Finance Commission has ever had. And it is regressive in many ways. Unprecedented that you actually, the Finance Commission has been asked to revoke the earlier Finance Commission award. The Finance Commission has been asked to do things that is it cannot do, like you make provisions for resources for Make in India. Now that's not the council's responsibility. Make in India may be a centrally sponsored scheme. Let the center fund it. Why should Finance Commission get into it? And as if it wasn't enough, the original regressive terms were not enough, which caused a lot of furor in the system. Southern states reacted to it because of demographics. The date was, you know, population control states.
1971 to 2011.
But beyond that, towards the end of its term, while it's ending, an additional term of reference was brought in, which was not really surprising. Additional terms of reference come, but they haven't come so late. And this time it was about allocating monies for defense. Now, what the center is trying to do here is to pass on some part of his responsibility, which is defense, and say, carve out something else for us. And my apprehension is, given the overall environment in the country today, given the way it has functioned, the Finance Commission will come out with a recommendation of earmarking 20%, 25%, I don't know, it hasn't come yet, for to be outside the visible pool. Now, that is going to be a disaster. Because then what you've really done is you have fiscally choked the states, and no amount of buoyancy, and this is happening at a time when there's a slowdown, when GST collections are not very good.
State budgets will shrink, state governments will not be able to provide the public goods that they have promised their voters.
Absolutely.
And in some ways, all these things will come together. For some of the more prosperous states, we are speaking right now in Kerala, they might discover that both demographics and the GST and whatever have all
and the slowdown
have all gone against them, and suddenly they will have no way to provide the education and health that they that their voters have been demanding of them.
Yeah, see, also that what you're doing, there also has been a move to directly fund the panchayats. Now, 3.5 lakh crores is going annually to do that. So at some level, what's happening is that the panchayats are nibbling at the heels of the states. From the top, the center is squeezing them. This layer of governance, which is important, I mean, the main layer of governance, state governments, is getting emaciated. And if that collapses, that, I think, is the federal compact. And that is what...
And so that you think that, that India, as a union of states, this federal notion of our country is...
Over. Yeah, absolutely. That is my big worry.
And that's where we leave you. Thank you. Thank you, Haseeb.